Talk about two very, very important topics of research. In fact, you can consider them hearts and lungs of research. They are that important. So remember, we are talking for the nth time. Nth time. Whenever we do a study, what type of study we are doing, whatever result you find signifies one of the four things. Can you please tell us what is that?
For that, bias, confounding,
chance,
yeah.
And the result.
Sister you. Whenever we find, do a study, and the findings that we get, it may signify one of the four things. Can you tell us, like, what are those four?
Bias,
chance, confounding, or the number four is true association. Okay, the result is valid. So the first three are not valid. The fourth one is the true one. So today we'll talk about the confounding. That means the muddy one. The relationship that we are examining, something is muddying that relationship. Something is contaminating that relationship. Something is affecting that relationship. If we do not have information on that, we are in trouble. That's what confounding is. Suppose, and not suppose, we are always interested in to examine the relationship between exposure and the disease. And anytime we are testing this relationship, we are very aware of this factor, the C. Because this C is important to understand, is very important in the context of this relationship. If we do not have information about the C, whatever result we will get will be biased, will be a distorted result, will be a spurious result, will be a faulty result, will be a false result. So this C is the confounder of that relationship. Confounder. Prophet, I heard, I'm a Bengali speaking person and try to give the meaning of the Arabic word, prophet. What is that? What is a kufr? Something to hide. Isn't it? There is a one, the base meaning of kufr is to hide. Because the truth is that we are created by God. Yes, the faith. And the kufr means to hide that relationship. So confounder is something that hides this relationship. Okay? Confounder is a very problematic in cross-sectional, case control, and follow-up studies. Are you clear about that? Very problematic. And not really a problem in the randomized controlled trial. Why is that? Because of the randomization, all factor, all confounder, whether we know it or we do not know it, are equally distributed between the study arms. What is different at the end is one group gets the treatment, other groups don't get the treatment. So confounder is not a problem of the experimental randomized controlled trial. Yes.
How can they follow up studies for the confounder?
Okay, very good question. This brother is always keeps me on my toes. So, in the follow-up studies, you start with the exposure, then you are following for the disease outcome. One point is for sure, follow-up study, you will have less confounding than case control study. But confounder can be anything. We know it or we may not know it. And in the follow-up study, it depends on how much information you collect. What if you have done a follow-up study but did not collect all the relevant data, all the relevant information? So still follow-up data, a very good study you have conducted is prone to confounding. So let's take an example. We do a follow-up study of alcohol consumption and oral cancer. Okay, say we did that study and we found that the risk ratio is 5, meaning those who were drinker had 5 times the risk of developing oral cancer than those who did not drink. Make sense? Does that mean that alcohol drinking causes oral cancer? Well, from looking at this result, it's a very strong association. So maybe yes, maybe no. So before we conclude, consider this bias. The study that we conducted, did we incur any kind of bias? And inshallah, later in the lecture, we will know about different type of biases. Once we eliminated the bias, we have to consider, did we get this result by chance? Once we have eliminated that, the last thing we have to consider, is this a true relationship or something else is going on? Something else is covering it up, hiding it up. So, let's see. How do we know that? Try to answer the following two questions. What are the known and highly suspected risk factors for oral cancer? You have to answer that question. Your interest is alcohol. Definitely it is a risk factor for oral cancer. But what other factors also causes oral cancer? You have to think it through. That's why whenever you do a study, it needs a lot of reading, research, thinking on your part in order to design a very sound study. Because if you don't think it through, you will never collect the relevant information that you need to collect in the first place. And then you have to ask yourself this question. The two study groups that you are interested in, alcohol drinker versus non-alcoholic drinker, do they differ in those factors? Now, if we know the answer of the first question, then we will know the answer of the second question. But if we don't think about this one, we will not be able to answer this question, which is very important in order to understand what is the true relationship between an exposure and disease. So then you started thinking, and you come up with this answer, and from the reading, that cigarette smoking is a known cause of oral cancer. So then it becomes imperative that you also collect smoking data. And what you found when you interviewed the people, that the drinking and smoking goes hand in hand. Those who are drinker inevitably also smoke cigarette. Okay. So you adjust your analysis for the smoking. Now, when you adjust for the smoking, you have to compare these two risk ratio for the drinking. Unadjusted effect was for drinking was 5. Now adjusted effect of drinking is 2 once you take the smoking into account. Now you can, now it's a judgment call. And anybody will tell you that yes, this relationship, the relationship between the drinking and the oral cancer is confounded by smoking because the risk ratio varied greatly. This is the basic idea. I don't want to go into the math of it. Just in this class, you will try to understand the concept. Yes? Unadjusted. When you first did the study, studied the relationship between alcohol and oral cancer, you found the risk ratio of 5, meaning those who drink are 5 times more likely to get the oral cancer than who don't drink. But you, in this relationship, there is an unadjusted one. You didn't take into account their smoking history. Later on, when you think about it more thoroughly, you found out that there is smoking might be a factor. Smoking might be a confounder in that relationship. Fortunately, you thought it through and you collected the smoking data too. And when you adjusted the analysis again for smoking, the risk ratio instead of 5 turned into 2. Now, the true relationship, once you adjusted for smoking, those who drink alcohol have the 2 times the risk of getting oral cancer. Previously, they were at a higher risk, 5 times the risk. That risk reduced to 2. So, your conclusion is the relationship between alcohol and oral cancer is confounded by smoking. Okay.
When we see this adjusted is risk is 2, what means that we relate the smoking with the cancer or with the smoking
okay.
With the cancer?
Okay. Here it would be. Try to understand it. So when you didn't have the smoking data, you only had alcohol data and the oral cancer data.
It will be
the relationship is 5 risk ratio. Meaning those who are drinker were 5 times more likely to get oral cancer. Once you adjusted that data with the smoking, the risk ratio reduced from 5 to 2.
Of the same alcohol and
the same alcohol and the oral cancer. Now you can make this judgment call that the relationship between alcohol and oral cancer is confounded by smoking. And how do you know that? Because as soon as you adjusted for smoking, the risk ratio changed. That is the diagnostic criteria for confounding. Yes.
Could we say that confounding that we are looking for other causes, risk factors that may lessen the relationship between two factors?
Precisely, exactly. Yes.
I thought it would really the RR will be higher.
There are 2 types of confounding. I don't want to go into the details. It can go up. It can go down. There are 2 types of confounding, called positive confounding and negative confounding. The idea is, unadjusted one. Whatever unadjusted relationship you have, once you adjust for the confounding, it will never be the same. It will may go up or go down in the true relationship where it belongs. Let's look at some pictures. It will be way more clearer to you. Criteria for a confounder. Not any factor you can say is a confounder. That factor has to meet three criteria in order to be a confounder. The number one, a variable is a confounder if it is an independent risk factor of the disease. Okay. Number two, it is unevenly distributed among the exposed and non-exposed. In a very simple word, a variable is a confounder if it is a risk factor of the disease and if it is associated with the exposure. That's what it means, if it is associated with the exposure. And number three, it is very important, that confounder must not stand on the causal pathway between the exposure and disease. So these are all like, hey, thanks. It's not that clear. It will be clear if you understand this picture. Very, very important. When a factor is a confounder, this is your exposure, this is the disease. Exposure, disease, exposure, disease. C is a confounder if it is a risk factor of the disease and the risk factor of the exposure. An example, you know, age is related to the stroke. The older you get, the higher the chance that you're going to get stroke. Older you get, your hair gets gray. So anytime you are examining the relationship between gray hair and stroke, if you do not collect the information on age, you will not find the true relationship. So age is a confounder of this relationship. And age is, in this instance, what? Independent risk factor of the disease, independent risk factor of the exposure. And this confounder is not standing on the causal pathway.
Yes.
Make one clarification.
Yes.
You see, if you do not collect the data on age, then you may conclude that gray hair causes a stroke, or stroke causes gray hair. You understand that? Now, since age is related both to gray hair and stroke, so then it becomes a confounder. So collecting, and it is an independent risk factor also, for both of them. Okay?
Because you may have younger, people, they have gray hair normally. But
like me?
Yes.
Yes.
I'm very young and I've got gray hair. Right? Thank you.
In the second example, it is very important that you understand the example, because these three examples are not exactly the same. Here, and by the way, before you understand, we need to understand the arrow. It makes, there are a lot of information even in the direction of the arrow. You see that this arrow is directed at one direction. Here the arrow is on both directions. So in the first instance, wherever the point the arrow is directed, it is the risk factor. And here it is not a risk factor, it is with just an association. C and F are associated. Association and risk factor is not the same thing. So let's look at the second example. Here, confounder is a independent risk factor, and I'm not saying association, risk factor of the disease, confounder is associated with the exposure. And confounder is not standing in the causal pathway. How do you understand that? Okay. Again, age is an independent risk factor for breast cancer. Older women are more likely to get breast cancer. And older women is related to the number of children. The higher the age, the higher your children, the number of children. But it is an association. It is not a risk factor. Many women, they may not have any children. Okay? So anytime you assess the relationship of the number of children and breast cancer, you may find a relationship. But that relationship is not a true relationship unless and until you also collect the data on age and adjust for age. Once you adjust for the age, you may not find any relationship because all of the effect is concentrated on age. Does that make sense? Let's talk about the second example. Again, C is an independent risk factor of the disease, and C is associated with the exposure. And exposure is associated with the disease, not a causal pathway. Say for example, smoking in this relationship. Smoking is an independent risk factor of chronic heart disease. We all know that. And since this example is coming from the West, we have to understand it in the context of West. Smoking is associated with house renting. Meaning, in the West, if you are a smoker, many homeowners will not be interested in renting their apartment to you. They want smoke-free renter. Okay? So now, you are interested in the relationship whether those who are rent their house are more likely to get chronic heart disease. So you collected the data whether a person is a renter or a owner. And you found that those who rent the house are less likely to get the heart disease. And you think, oh, it's better to rent the house than to own a house. Okay? You concluded that. It's a justified conclusion. But what had happened is, if you collected the smoking data, then you would know that house owner is free to smoke at his house. He doesn't need anybody's permission. But these renters are more or less all non-smoker, because if they are a smoker, they wouldn't be getting the house in the first place. So because smoking is related to the chronic heart disease, so renting a house means you are a non-smoker, so you are less likely in the risk. So that's the importance of the confounder. So you have to have the relation. You have to collect the information. Now, when a factor is not a confounder, we need to understand that too. And it is my humble experience. Whenever we do research, we have gotten used to such that mathematical modeling, whatever variable we collect, we just throw. We call it kitchen sink. You put everything into the model and then you find your result. But for every variable, you have to think it through. Does it meet the criteria of a confounder or not? If it doesn't meet, you do not take that factor into consideration. But we don't do that because we don't have time, and you know, many of us also don't have the understanding. So let's look at the example. Here, C is a risk factor of the disease. Confounder is a risk factor of the outcome. But confounder here has no relationship with the exposure. If it doesn't have any relationship with the exposure, you cross it out right away. No, I don't need to know this information in order to test this relationship. Because this will not affect this relationship. For example, we know that diet high in cholesterol is an independent risk factor for chronic heart disease. And smoking is also related to the chronic heart disease. And what you are testing in your study is that what role smoking plays in acquiring chronic heart disease. So do you need to adjust the analysis for the high cholesterol diet? That is the question. In the first instance, it feels like, yeah, I need to adjust for it. But in reality, these two factors doesn't have any relationship. Whether someone eats fatty food or not has nothing to do with whether someone smokes. For example, those who smoke, more likely to drink and many other things. But smoking has never been proven that it also affects how, whether a person eat high fat diet or low fat diet. Since it has not been proven, then we don't need to adjust for the diet in order to understand this relationship. Yes?
Related somehow to sedentary life and animal to diet. So it's more than just practical. The one who's eating a healthy diet, usually has more. They explore. So related together.
I see your point. Yes. You are coming in a very in a different route that those who are smoker, are they more likely to be sedentary?
Yes.
I do not know of any reason. Smoking may affect the appetite. A person who is a smoker may eat, I don't know the research, eat less, but does it affect what kind of food he eats? It is an example, but the example comes from the real data, real life data. It's all real life data. The second instance, confounder is related to the exposure. Confounder has no relationship with the disease. So this is not a confounder. For example, if you don't eat any fruit, your diet will be very low in vitamin C. And if you're low in vitamin C, you are more likely to get scurvy. But eating fruit is not related to the scurvy because you can get vitamin C tablet form. It's not necessarily that we have to eat fruit in order to get scurvy. So that's why eating fruit has no weight when you examine this relationship. This is a very important one. Confounder is a risk factor of the disease. Met the number one criteria. Number two, exposure is a risk factor of the confounder. Did not meet the second criteria. But what is more important, it violated the third criteria. Confounder cannot sit on the pathway between the exposure and the disease. Let's look at here. You know the fibrinogen is a risk factor for chronic heart disease. smoking, whether you are smoking, it affects your fibrillar cell. So you are testing the relationship between smoking and the chronic heart disease. And if you adjust for fibrinogen level, it will give you a false result. Why? Because smoking affects the fibrinogen in turn affects the chronic heart disease. So actually what you have done, you have adjusted the data on a you have adjusted the data on a factor that is standing on the pathway of the disease. And you cannot adjust the data on a factor that stands on the pathway between the exposure and the disease. You cannot do that. The last one, the sick. Here, the disease is a risk factor. The disease itself is a risk factor for the confounder. Exposure is a risk factor for the confounder. So if you want to examine this relationship, you don't need to adjust for this. For example, you know that those who are heavy drinker, they more likely to use aspirin. You know why? Peptidase, they will take antacid. Those who drink get headache. Don't they? Hangover, we call it hangover. Do you know what hangover is?
No.
So the drinker usually drinks at night. And the morning when he wakes up, he gets a huge headache. So in order to relieve his headache, he takes aspirin. So the drinking is a risk factor for aspirin take. Whenever you suffer an MI, we prescribe them to take low dose aspirin, don't we? So anytime you are testing the relationship between drinking and MI, you don't need to control for aspirin because it has not fulfilled the criteria of the confounder. The criteria for confounder, for recapitulation, one more time. It has to be the risk factor of the disease. Number two, it has to be associated with exposure. And number three, very important, it must not stand on the causal pathway between exposure and the disease. It is not easy to understand the concept of confounder. You stay in research for 5-10 years and still we don't get it. So the more you read, the more you learn, and the more that concept will come clear. Yes?
The last example.
Uh-huh.
Even if it's not profound,
yes.
Change the results.
I don't want to go into the details. Yes, it changes the result. You are absolutely right. But then it causes a bias. We call it stratification bias. It's a very higher concept. And we don't, what are the things that we don't want our study? Is one thing we don't want is we don't want our result to be biased. So by controlling for aspirin, you thinking that you are doing good, but you are actually will be harming the result by introducing bias. Does that make sense? In the beginning there was no bias, but by you thought that, oh, this is a confounder, I better adjust for it. And your intention was good, but a good intention turned into a bad result. You introduced biases. This is a higher level steps of stratification. So, how do you control for confounder? Very important, control for confounder. Before you start the study, you must think it through over and over. Because if you don't think it through, and if you don't collect appropriate data, you will never be able to control for confounder. So, In the design phase, what you can do is you can limit who can get into your study and who can't. Remember I gave you the example of alcohol and oral cancer and smoking is a confounder. You already know that. Hey, smoking will cause confounding. So I want to test the relationship between drinking and oral cancer in only non-smoker. You can enter into my study if you don't smoke, because I know that smoke contaminates this relationship. So I don't want you if you are a smoker and a drinker. But if you are a drinker and not a smoker, come join. If you do that, you limit the confounding. Smoking is not a problem in your study. But why don't we do that? The problem is, whenever you do that, not everybody will be eligible to be in your study. You are constricting, you are carving out your target population. Your target population will be smaller and smaller. And now, what are you going to do with your result? You enrolled all the non-smoker, tested the relationship of alcohol and the oral cancer. Will your result be valid for those who are smoker? No. Your result is no longer generalizable to the larger audience. So, although this is a very tempting idea, usually we don't do that because we don't limit ourselves. A second strategy that you can take at the design phase, and it's hugely popular, is called matching. What you do, think about it, you have three factors, A, B, C. A is your exposure, and B is a confounder, and C is a confounder. Okay, now, especially matching we do in case control study. Case control study, usually the sample size is very small, between 200 to 500, usually. Okay, so whenever you are dealing with a small sample, and again it's a statistical issue and we don't want to get into the details, whenever you have a small sample, you cannot, in the analysis, you cannot adjust for many factors. So one thing we do is, okay, I want to examine the effect of A, that is our exposure. But if I collect the data on B and also on C, then I don't have enough people to adjust for them. So then I will say that I am going to match the disease and the non-disease on B and C. I will match them. There will be like, think about the randomization control trial. The intervention and the control are similar in the in relationship to the confounder. The only difference they have is one group has the treatment and other group doesn't. So the matching is something like that. Only you choose two or three strong confounder of the relationship. And you say, I am going to match the cases and the control based on those two, three factors. So they will be similar in respect to this two, three confounder. And so at the analysis, all I will have is the exposure of interest. So that's what the matching concept is. Is that clear? Does that make sense?
Okay, what's the difference with this matching and the one before?
Thank you.
This is disease, and this is, they don't have the disease. And you are interested whether they have exposure or not. This is the relationship you are interested in. So now, what you do is say factor A, factor B, factor C, factor D. All of these influences this relationship. So what can you do? You match the case and control on A, on B, on C, on D. So all the at the end, all you have, the difference between the two groups is the exposure, whether someone, whether the group has exposure or not. That's a simple idea of the matching. So any potential confounder that you think that will affect this relationship, you match them on. So you can test whatever exposure you are interested in. So for example, your exposure of interest is alcohol. And your outcome is oral cancer. And here you know that age is a confounder, because the higher the age, the more the drinking, higher the age, more likely to get oral cancer. So you say that, okay, I am going to match the cases and control and on age. If the first case I'm getting is 55 years, the second, the control that I will choose will also be 55 years. Next one, the case is 54, the control will be 54. So you matched, age is no longer affecting this relationship. So at the end, what you can do is test this association. That's what matching is.
So that means you know the confounder.
You know the confounder and you match them.
You match them for the control.
Yes, you make the cases and the control exactly the same, as much as you can.
Okay, for the previous slide, for this one, what's the concept of this one?
Here, this, you are not matching it. You are saying that you think that, okay,
I don't actually
people
want to
really don't burden you to explain this. Disadvantages, it costs time and money, and sometimes you overmatch it. And I don't want to explain that either. Already I can look at the face that you are getting lost. So just try to understand, like, remember that matching. Confounder must be a risk factor for the disease, and confounder has to be associated with the exposure. Yes. Yes.
I mean, if we have at least confounders, all of them are risk factors.
We talked about two methods in the design phase, and now there are two methods in the analytical phase. The first one is the stratification. Let's read this. You stratify the data according to the level of the suspected confounding factors, take a weighted average, and compare the crude and the adjusted estimate to see where there is confounding. It's not clear. Let's look at an example, what I mean by that. You do a case control study of coffee consumption and MI. Coffee is your exposure and MI is your disease.
the crude odds ratio you get is 2.25, meaning those who drink coffee are more than two times more likely to get MI than those who don't drink coffee. So your conclusion is coffee is bad for health. Coffee causes MI. Now, what you didn't think about is smoking. Fortunately, you thought about it, that smoking might be a confounder of this relationship. Smoking causes the disease, MI, and those who are smokers are also more likely to drink coffee. So then, you tested this relationship between coffee drinking and MI in two separate groups, in non-smoker and smoker. And then you found the relationship between the coffee and the disease in non-smoker 1.4 and in a smoker 1.3. And they are very different from 2.25. So then, since they are very similar, you make an average of these two, and this average is the adjusted odds ratio. Yesterday we talked about age adjusted, so now you have a smoking adjusted odds ratio. You compare the crude means when you did not take into account any other factor, it's 2.25 and adjusted is 1.37. Now it is your judgment call. Is the relationship of the coffee and MI confounded by smoking? Looking at these two numbers, you will conclude yes. Last at the analysis phase that we do is we control the confounder through modeling or the multivariate analysis. And we will learn a little bit about them in the next week. So, have I warned you out with the confounding? Yes? Yes, very good.